Thanks very much, and I just hope you will not be disappointed, because yesterday, sorry?
Is
now, okay, more, okay. Yesterday I gave a speech which was more popular. Today I thought I can be a little bit more theoretical. I hope you will not be disappointed. I thought I'm among leftists who still have a sense for theory. I would like to begin with status of ideology today. I mean, officially we say we live in post-ideological world, who cares about these big projects, big systems, and so on and so on. But is this so? Let me give you an example from my own recent experience. The very term ideology is slowly prohibited. Like, you know that now me and Sophie Fiennes are trying to do part two, much more directly political, of the Pervert's Guide to Cinema. It's Pervert's Guide to Ideology. First it was accepted by Channel 4, then what I will tell you is not a joke. Then they made a suggestion that they said it's an excellent project, just, my God, we no longer have ideology today. Why don't you change the title? And they seriously suggested, like, a pervert's guide to today's spiritual tendencies. I mean, don't use that word, and so on, no? So, where do we have ideology? Okay, let me proceed step by step. I would like to begin with a simple reference to popular cinema, because more and more I think that if you want to detect the changes in predominant hegemonic ideological mood, the best way, because there you get the change at its purest, is to see at different remakes of the same film. And this came to me when I saw, and I think it's a terrifying bad film, terribly bad film, now with Will Smith, I Am Legend. And then do you know that there are 4 versions, the novel and 3 further cinema versions. And it makes me so sad, because I've seen and read them all, how if you take them one after the other, it's a very sad story of regression. I'm not saying that the novel is a great novel, but it's very solid, if not left, at least left, liberal, multicultural message. You know what the title refers to. It's a very nice reversal of perspective. It's the story of the last survivor after some unspecified catastrophe. All normal humans died except this guy, and some kind of vampire-like entities survive and stalk him. At the novel's end, to cut a long story short, they get him, and just before executing him from his prison cell, he hears their commenting on him and gets the point. I am legend. In the sense of, in the same way that for us humans, vampires were legends, the others experiences threatening to be killed, disposed of, he was now the legend for them. That's the whole, again, remember this. If you saw the last film, you can already see why. Then we have the first version, cinema version, still the best. Strangely made in Italy in 1964, the title is The Last Man on Earth, with Vincent Price as the hero. This still more or less follows the novel. It's okay. But already there is, since we are in Hollywood, a family values, as it were, shift. At the end, the guy is not simply executed, but he escapes his vampire guards in prison and runs towards where? Towards a church where he was years before married, and it's gunned down at the steps of the church, and so on and so on. Then there is, sorry, from 71, The Omega Man with Charlton Heston, which, okay, the good thing is that it drives surprisingly the proper ideological line of division. The story here is that after this catastrophe which wiped out almost all humanity, the conflict is between enlightened people, people who still cling to our rational scientific legacy and try to deal with catastrophe rationally, and with crazy lunatics who thought this is divine punishment and we need victims, to sacrifice people, and so on and so on. That's almost, I'm tempted to say, in a very moderate way, of course, a good point. The bad point, unfortunately, is that we get a shift from this, how should I put it, multiculturalist reversal, like what they were for us, we are now for them. And I think, permit me here a brief introduction, this is, I think, the beginning of modernity. This is what in modern universalism is still very progressive. It's very fashionable today to attack Descartes, cogito, you know, that guy. As, I don't know what, but wait a minute. You know, check it up in his discourse on method, how he begins. He said that, in very touching, simple terms, that as a young man, he perceived the customs and so on of others, stupid, meaningless, but then he asked himself, what if for others our own customs also appear in the same way, stupid, weird, and so on and so on. That relativization of one's own position, the ability to see one's own background as contingent, that's the beginning of philosophical wisdom. Which is why, although it's very fashionable to say that the Cartesian cogito is male and so on, no, it's not as simple. To propose you the formula, to provoke my theoretical, not enemy, but I debate a lot with her, as you maybe know, but personally, I hope I can say, friend Judith Butler. No Judith Butler without Descartes. What do I mean by this? And she knows it, I think. This idea of Butler, which is a very modern idea, that we don't have a fixed identity in our nature, fixed identity either by divine will or by nature, but that our identity is a matter of something which is performatively constructed, constituted through practice and so on. This is a very Cartesian idea. This idea, again, of seeing the utter contingency of one's own specific cultural background. Here, incidentally, all authentic radical thought, I think, is anti-hermeneutic. If, let me be very precise here, if by hermeneutics we mean this kind of a reference to our specific background as the insurpassable determining horizon of our experience. You know, the idea being that whatever we do, we are always predetermined by our historical specificity and so on and so on, and all we can do, that's the lesson of Gadamer, maybe even more than Heidegger, all we can do is reflect in an always imperfect way, into reflect backwards into these implicit presuppositions, prejudices, which predetermine how we understand the world. I mean, the wager of Cartesian subjectivity, which is then, of course, decried by hermeneuticians as naive, is precisely that we can break out of this predetermination by tradition. But now I didn't lose my thread. Back to the line. So we have this the very focus of the novel and of the first version, this shattering experience of radical cultural relativity. What were they for us? Now we experience we are this for them. It may appear a simple reversal, but it works. Most of you are probably too young to remember it, but I remember it was already some 30, 40 years ago, with all liberal naivety that this implies, but on, I don't know which big TV company did a very naive TV, not documentary, but movie, fiction. It portrayed United States, a big city, I don't know, with exactly the way it was at that point, racism and so on, the only difference being that blacks were dominating and whites were mistreated. And it's incredibly, I remember what kind of a shock this caused, you know. Like all the uneasiness of white liberals, they said, isn't this too much of a revenge logic? We are trying to help the poor blacks. Is this what you get as gratitude or whatever? No. But you get my point. This simple reversal, this is unfortunately what gets lost in the man who had the honor to be the president of American Rifle Association, Charlton Heston. This is what is lost in that version. The movie shifts from this, how to call it, multiculturalist self-relativization towards the moment of redemption. The accent is that just on his point of dying, the hero just in the last minute produces the serum, the medicine to cure us, humanity, and now I am legend means something different. It means he is the legendary redeemer with whom humanity is. So it's no longer what others are for us, we are now, were for us, we are now for them. It's on the contrary, screw the others, let's overcome them. Now the last version, finally, is the worst. And this is especially interesting to note, since allegedly, as neoconservatives like to complain, we live in times where Hollywood is bombarding us with liberal leftist values and so on and so on. You know what happens, I will remind you if you haven't seen the film. The film takes place in Manhattan, typically. You know that Manhattan, New York has a very specific value in the neoconservative imaginary. Remember that in one of the great American novels, absolutely stupid sheet of science fiction by, I think, Pat Robertson, which is that got, I think, I don't know what, it's the huge gigantic wave, but which punishes the wrong America. It's LA, not even you, San Francisco, it's LA and New York, which disappear. So it's the site of secular decadence, promiscuity, and so on and so on. So typically, the movie takes place there. There, where the hero, called, as in the novel, Neville, is alone on Manhattan. Then one day, a woman appears, accompanied by a small son. She's coming from the Baptist American South and tells him that God has sent her to bring him to the colony of survivors, still full humans, up there in Vermont. Neville refuses to believe her, saying there cannot be a God in a world with such suffering and mass death. When the infected vampires attack the house that night and overrun its defenses, Neville, Anna, and Ethan, her boy, retreat into the basement laboratory, where in the last minute, Neville realizes that he found the cure. He then gives the cure to Anna and sacrifices himself so that he dies in order for Anna to escape up to Vermont. And just before dying, he, at the beginning of the film, a secular person, tells her, "Now I see that you were right. God sent you, everything was a divine plan. God sent you here to fulfill the mission. My part of the mission is to produce the serum, and now you can go." And then the last scene of the film is extremely depressing. It's really like kind of upper class green gated community, protected by a high wall, where the woman comes, and then in the off voice we hear this guy who sacrificed himself as a new Christ will be a legend. A legend for whom? For the redeemed new humanity. So you see the horror, my God, I'm almost tempted to talk like an old moralist. It's, where is there respect for the novel? It's exactly the opposite. It's not, I am legend for them, it's not this anti-racist self-relativization. No, he's a legend, not for vampires, but for the future humanity. Not to mention this play with the places, geographic. It's really, how to put it, a pact between Baptist fundamentalist South and these upper class gated communities, pseudo green New Age liberals, against the decadent big city New York. I mean, it's a breath. No, come to think of it, you know, because Will Smith pretends to be a liberal and so on, progressive film. But are we aware what we are getting in this film? Are we aware how far we progressed from the good, old, simple, liberal message, which unfortunately we have to repeat even today, that what they are for us, what if we are something in the same way terrifying for them? So don't be so sure that, I hope this demonstrates, don't be so sure that ideology is passé. Today, now next step. Today, ideology, I think, is more than ever a field of struggle. Among other things, the struggle for appropriating past traditions. Let me here repeat my example, which is maybe already known to you. The liberal appropriation of Martin Luther King. Let me quote Henry Louis Gates, who recently remarked, "Everyone knows, even the smallest kid knows, about Martin Luther King. Everybody can say his most famous moment was that I have a dream. But no one can go further than this one sentence. All we know is that this guy had a dream. We don't know what the dream was. Why? Because the dream was really, to put it in my Balkan experience, ethnically cleansed, purely, no? It is all the radical stuff, anti-militarism, anti-Vietnam War, support of workers' rights, all this disappeared to make him a kind of abstract liberal anti-racist. No, this was the high moment of King's, this is true, public visibility in 63. But my God, many things happened afterwards in the last 5 years of his life when he radicalized himself politically. For example, do you know that in Memphis, Tennessee, where he was shot, he didn't go there to fight only racism. He went there to support the striking workers. He was practically a pariah at the end of his life. That aspect is obliterated. And it's not only in this case, but are we aware that although I, following Marx, often, like many leftists, claim that the so-called bourgeois liberal freedoms are an organic part of capitalist economy, are the form of ideology which fits capitalist relations, but nonetheless, things are not as simple as that. Are you aware that most of the features we today identify with liberal democracy, like trade unions, universal vote, free universal education, freedom and the press, and so on, were not kind of automatic result of capitalism. They were won through a long, difficult struggle throughout the 19th century. I mean, what today is part of central liberal consensus was considered very extreme in early 19th century. Another ignored fact here in the United States, today, the equality between whites and blacks is, at least officially, celebrated as part of the American dream, perceived as a self-evident politico-ethical axiom. However, are you aware that in the 1920s and 30s, as much as we can laugh at them, and they were Soviet puppets, blah, 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 but nonetheless, one should be honest here. The American, of US, Communist Party was the only political force which argued for complete equality between the races. It's a simple fact that there were some religious group, but as a political force, I'm sorry to tell you, it was only the Communist Party which stood explicitly, not this liberal between the lines, yes, blacks are like children, we have to educate them a little bit more so that they will deserve it, and so on and so on. Another point, from my own part of the world, how in post-communist societies, Catholic Church like to present itself as the beacon of freedom, human rights, and so on, democracy. My God, look a little bit into history. Are you aware that the Catholic Church accepted democracy only at the end of the 19th century, with that famous papal encyclic on the so-called social question, or what I think the title is mit brennender Sorge, with burning care. In even there, check it out, you can get it on internet. Many things can be that enemies would prefer to forget. For the time being, we get them on internet. And then they say explicitly, for us, Catholic Church, the best form is still absolute monarchy. But tactically, in recent conditions, not to lose contact, to retain our influence, we tactically, in short term, accept democracy. I mean, that's explicit message. So, it's very interesting how things change. Now I'm coming to a more fundamental point. I think something similar is happening for what we, at least in Europe, were celebrating this spring and summer, the memory of 68. May Paris Revolt, or generally of the 60s. The 60s meant quite, I remember, I'm old enough, they meant different things at that point. They meant what? Not only sexual liberation, freedom of expression, introduction of the so-called me ego generation. They meant also, in France, at least in Europe, a crazy utopian, but nonetheless, attempt of a pact between workers and students. For me, the sublime moment of French May is not all those fantasy to power and into power and so on, but when thousands of students joined, I think, in Paris suburb, joined, went to the big Renault factory, joined with workers there and so on and so on. In other words, this fundamental problematization of capitalism, this in memory is disappearing. 60s remain as some kind of a new sensitivity, end of old obstacles, of old prohibitions, and so on and so on. So what happened, really? Here, a French book, which is one of these big, fat, unreadable books, but it's nonetheless interesting. Incidentally, if you want to study ideology in its material, empirical level, I find this an interesting phenomenon to be analyzed. Did you notice how today we have more and more big, fat books, which nobody reads them, but they're universally, but they're nonetheless reprinted all the time and universally referred to as classics. Let me give you some examples. And I don't think he's a very bad guy. John Rawls' Theory of Justice. I know people who wrote books on Rawls and admitted to me privately, which is why I will not name them, that they did not read. Then it's, for example, in philosophy, Robert Brandom making it explicit. You know that new argumentative theory of language, Habermas likes the book, like 610 pages, a big classic, people don't read it. Then Habermas himself, Theory of Communicative Action, people don't read it, and so on and so on. Unfortunately, the book I will refer to is also one of these. It's Luc Boltanski and Yves Chapello, The New Spirit of Capitalism, which I think, focusing on France, very in great detail, very appropriately describes how the legacy of the 60s was reappropriated, exploited by capitalism to give to capitalism like a new lease of life. The thesis of the book is that from the 1970s onwards, a new figure of the spirit of capitalism, that's the ironic reference to Max Weber, of course, Max Weber, is emerging. Capitalism abandoned the hierarchical Fordist structure of the production process and developed a network-based form of organization founded on employee initiative and autonomy in the workplace. Instead of hierarchical centralized chain of command, we get networks with a multitude of participants organizing work in the form of teams or projects intent on customer satisfaction and a general mobilization of workers thanks to their leaders' vision. In this way, capitalism is transformed and legitimized as an egalitarian project. By way of accentuating autopoietic interaction and spontaneous self-organization, it even usurped, appropriated the far left's rhetoric of workers' self-management and turned it from anti-capitalist to a capitalist slogan. The idea, it's incredibly how successful was, at least in Europe, this operation. The all anti-hierarchic rhetoric was put in this way as if the hierarchic enemy are communists, Eastern Europeans, while our capitalism is, and you can put here, inject all this negri postmodern rhetorics, multitude, molecular, self-organization, whatever you want. At the level of consumption, this new spirit is the one of the so-called cultural capitalism. And I think they are right. Today, more and more, why do we buy commodities? Or to be more precise, by the publicity, by the public space of ideology, how are we addressed when we are solicited to buy commodities? We have three levels here. First, the idea was that you buy a commodity to satisfy some of your needs, either they are real or imagined, whatever, like buy a car which is relatively inexpensive, runs fast, it's comfortable, whatever. Somehow it's related to your, again, of course, ideologically constructed, but nonetheless needs. Then, as we all know, with consumerism proper, we get the shift from real properties of the product to the symbolic level of competition and status symbol. You don't buy a Land Rover simply because you need it, but because you want to, how do you put it, keep up with the Joneses. You want to assert yourself, declare yourself, certain status symbol, and so on and so on. But there are good reasons to admit that today this is no longer the quite appropriate formula. There is a New Age spiritualist twist. Today, for example, if you are bombarded with publicity to buy a Land Rover, it would be neither, you know, how much, what it can do, the utility of the car, nor the simple symbolic social value in the sense of certain status symbol and so on. It would rather be a reference to your inner satisfaction, development of yourself, and so on and so on. It is that it allows you to live, for example, by buying a Land Rover and not a car, a big city limousine car, you signal that you want to remain to yourself. It's not even a social symbol, that you want a certain life attitude. You want to be more authentic, connected with Earth. You can drive on roar, not only on streets. It allows you to realize yourself, to find whatever. And even, I think, all that sheet of charity and solidarity and so on functions like that. It would be very nice, I think, to interpret in this slightly evil way even the organic food movement. It's a big business, but I'm utterly skeptical here. You know, my identification of organic apples is that they're usually a little bit rotten and look worse. So I always have a suspicion that they're all the same apples. First, they take out the nice apples and sell them pre-packed. What remains? They proclaim it organic and sell them at double the price. Why? Because you are, let's be serious. I don't think you really believe that you are buying them for the actual properties, less chemical additions, whatever. No, I think that it makes you feel good. Look, I'm doing something for Mother Earth. Look, you know, you signal that you are not just a blind consumer, but you want to do something, you care for humanity, and so on and so on. This, I think, this, how should I put it, this idea of buying commodities in order to achieve the authentic fulfillment of my true self. It can be the sensuous play of experience, caring for others. Like, for example, Starbucks are very good at this. Almost always when I enter it, I'm shocked about how, you know, they basically their message is, with each $4 cup of coffee, you save a Guatemala child from starvation or whatever. Like, it makes you feel good and so on, no? I mean, I think, I'm not, the true low-class aggressive reaction to is it, and I would love it. And if you are truly a leftist, you will see that it's just attacking ideology. It's not tasteless cruelty than it appears. It would be to say, no, fuck off. With each cup of coffee that I drink, I want two children more to die, or what? This, of course, doesn't mean what it says, but it means you reject this feel-good hypocrisy, how should I put it, no? Part of this is even detectable even in sciences, where this new spirit of capitalism articulated itself as the rise of a new discipline. I think it's very symptomatic of our times. So-called happiness studies. You know that this is now more and more a discipline. But as a psychoanalytic pessimist, I cannot help but noticing that it is how it is that precisely today, in our era of spiritualized hedonism, when the goal of life is directly defined as happiness, you know, today ideology no longer really interpellates you as sacrifice yourself for your country. No, it's kind of a vague call, be truly yourself. Enjoy life, of course, they would have not in the cheap sense of just consummation, but in the sense of inner fulfillment, and so on and so on. But how is it that precisely today anxiety and depression are exploding? Here, psychoanalysis can be of some help. So let me go on. So you saw the paradox, how through this new spirit of capitalism, humanitarian, charitable, and so on, the ruling ideology, pretty triumphantly, I think, reappropriated the legacy of the 60s, so that finally Bill Gates is the 68 fully integrated into the spirit of capitalism. What remained, the central element in all this, is the rejection of ideology. Anti-ideological rhetoric, which is, I think, crucial part of what Bill Gates recently propagates as creative capitalism. The message is, forget about old ideological struggles. My God, people are suffering, dying all around. Who has time to deal with capitalism, socialism, all that? Let's just all get together and finally do something. I think the ideological stakes are very clear. This is why charity, not only charity, but even this state of emergency rhetorics, like how can you live peacefully in your ivory tower when people are starving, children are dying in Africa? The message is, don't think, do something so that you don't have to think. It's direct depoliticizing strategy. The basic model is here an abstract humanization. Like today it's fashionable to emphasize we are not just ideological categories, we are full human persons with our anxieties, weaknesses, and so on. Even in the movies you find the same. I find it absolutely disgusting that, you know, Spider-Man, Batman, and so on. Did you notice how in all new installments of these sagas, we get what some critics, who must be really stupid, even described positively as that, for example, in the last film I read, Batman is no longer just a flat cartoon hero. We see his anxieties, fears, incertitudes, as if this somehow makes him more human and it's art movie. No, I think this humanization, this emphasis on we are also human beings, is the tool of ideology today. For example, let me give you an example of this. I saw Claude Lanzmann's Not Shoah. I have problems with that film, but it's much more interesting, ideological. His later 5-hour documentary from 1994, Tzal, Hebrew acronym for Israeli Defense Forces, is the portrayal after the 73 war of a moment of Israeli Defense Forces. And the thesis of the film is best rendered by the statement of an Israeli officer interviewed there who says, in my family, genetic is not military. That is to say, the film endlessly repeats this motif, members of Israeli military forces are not some perfect soldiers, they are ordinary men, one is a farmer, the other is an engineer, the other is a writer, with their ordinary fears, they were scared and so on. You see them when they are reviving their war experience, how they cry, they're like in their full and humanity with weaknesses and so on and so on. I think this is ideology at its purest. Why? Because by this emphasis on I'm also a full human being, and at the end, towards the end of this documentary, I don't know if it's available here, but I bought it in France, even Ariel Sharon appears, but you know how, as a farmer in the middle with his flock of sheep and so on, like, poor guy, he would just like to be there with all the animals, and poor guy, against his nature, he has to fight, and so on and so on. This is a very elegant way, I claim, to avoid the political topic of what your acts mean, this humanization. I mean, you can justify anything with this, my God. I mean, I have no doubt that you can redeem even Hitler in this way. He was, I'm absolutely sure, a warm human person who had his own weaknesses and traumas or whatever you want of this. This is why, let me go a little bit further into a provocation. This is why I think you can always rely on I'm sorry to tell you, and I will explain why, on political correctness to produce some stupidity in the form of a wisdom. And the stupidity that I hate most is one formula which sounds so deep of against having an enemy. It goes like this. I think this was the motto of one of these conferences for tolerance. Enemy is someone whose story we did not yet hear. I mean, no, it sounds so deep, you know, like, I objectivize you because I don't see you in the entirety of your personality, but the moment I see, hear your side of the story, I see, again, the Batman Spider-Man story, that you are a person like me with your weaknesses, fears, dreams, and so on, and you cannot be any longer truly my enemy. The same strategy was used in some European countries, I know of Iceland and United Kingdom, England. Along these lines, the pro-tolerance strategy is to practice so-called living libraries. The government or city authority pays members of sexual, ethnic, religious minorities to visit the mainstream white whatever people and just talk to them. The idea is they will experience you as a person and blah, blah. Sounds nice, but this procedure obviously has limits. The limit is what? Let me just replace the general statement with a concrete one. Would you also say Hitler was our enemy because we were not ready to listen to hear his story and so on? No, why not? Because stories that we are telling ourselves about ourselves, these stories are not the truth, they are lies. The truth is in what we do. Take Hitler, or Heydrich, or Himmler, or whomever you want, Eichmann. He was telling himself a story. I don't doubt there was a very intimate experience of what he was doing and so on. But I claim basically, this immediate personally, apparently non-ideological self-experience, was a lie constructed to enable him to blind himself for the horror of what he is doing. The truth is not in his inner experience. The truth is in what he was socially doing. If you look deep into a person, you always discover some stupid, authentic depth. It's irrelevant. Even, for example, how can you praise these moments of self-withdrawal and reflection? Let me quote you a wisdom of a well-known psychiatrist. Quote, "It is not only about the time you spend in prayer, nor the position you adopt, bodily position, while you are praying, but about a series of moments when you dive into yourself, which we could describe as pulling yourself together, where you calm down the passionate and obsessive reliving of everyday life. For each and every housewife, it is that solitary early morning coffee when the household has still not woken up." You know who is the author of these lines? Radovan Karadžić. And that's what I'm saying. You cannot say this is not authentic. I claim, who knows, maybe it is. And let me make even a step further here, just to remind you, which I already did in one of my books. If you are old enough to be old hippies, like me, you must remember D.T. Daisetsuteitaro Suzuki, the big popularizer of Zen Buddhism and so on and so on. There is unfortunately another side of this story. The same Suzuki in the 30s and 40s fully, passionately supported Japanese militarism, invasion of China and so on and so on. Now comes the beauty. Not only he supported it, he even provided in Buddhist terms active justification of it. How? For Suzuki, the attitude of total immersion into the selfless now, this instant enlightenment, satori, in which all reflexive distance is lost and I am what I do. This attitude perfectly legitimizes one's subordination to the militaristic social machine. So his idea is that for ordinary people, the fastest way to reach enlightenment, Zen Buddhist enlightenment, satori, is perfect obedience to social discipline. His example is when you hear the order, shoot the enemy, and you immediately do it without reflecting, you did overcome your false self. within this attitude, the warrior no longer acts as a person. He is truly subjectivized. And Suzuki himself here provided a wonderful phenomenological description intended to render to soldiers, to render killing much easier. How? Here is a quote. "It is really not he, the soldier, but the sword itself that does the killing. The soldier had no desire to do harm to anybody, but the enemy appears and makes himself a victim. It is as though the sword performs automatically its function of justice, which is the function of mercy." So you see, the idea is that if you acquire Buddhist enlightenment, you are not traumatized by killing people, because it is as if you are an external observer of your own acts. I stab you, but it's wrong to say that I stab you with my sword. My sword is moving, your body, I don't know how, gets stuck on my sword. I'm for nothing, reduced to the passive observer of my own acts. And what's my point here? It is that, again, you cannot dismiss this as cheap sophistry and so on. The truth is not at this level. Truth is not a matter of inner experience, of personal character and so on and so on. That's what I was witnessing, and I was sad for you American citizens, but in my country things are even worse at this moment. I think it's kind of a general ideological regression. When I was watching, namely, Republican convention, the first thing that did strike me is an unbelievable, truly unbelievable contradiction between explicit statements and the spectacle, the way these statements were announced, which undermines them. It's pure contradiction. First, I couldn't bite laugh. They all the time emphasized, don't make Sarah Palin a woman, mother, she's like us, don't focus on family, don't exploit the family. They were saying this like family was there all the time visible. The stupid brats, the small girl whom I hate, you know, licking the small boys and so on. I mean, like, the message is don't manipulate the family, and they ruthlessly manipulate the family there. Or they all the time talk about change, change, but they are even worse than Obama here. What change? Change is, as they say, enough of less state, enough of corrupted Washington politics, less taxes, firmer, more aggressive foreign politics. But my God, I mean, isn't this what Republicans are saying all the time? And I found it, on the top of it, a little bit ridiculous to talk about less taxes and so on, or less state expenditure, where we all know the story, my God. The public debt exploded with Reagan. I even remember very well, maybe if you are old enough, also you do, one of Reagan's almost funny statements, when he was accused at one press conference that he neglects, doesn't care about the exploding public debt, which is big, tremendous. He was almost funny. You know what was Reagan's answer? I think our public debt, it's a big enough boy who can take care of himself. And so it's big enough. And as you probably know, whatever you think of Clinton, I don't have too high opinion of him, but at least under Clinton, the balance was stabilized, and then it is Bush again where the public debt exploded. So how can this guy, that's beyond my European comprehension, how can these guys talk about, but okay, let's go to more serious thing. Then all the time they talked against, you know, like presenting Democrats as media people, media manipulation, style, performance against substance. Of course, they did this in a perfectly organized performance. Then McCain said yesterday, against, he wants to reach beyond partisan lines and so on and so on. How can he say this at a convention, which was one big cultural war act of us against them? I mean, but most important, and this is what makes me a little bit, now comes the serious argument, I would worry. I don't worry that Sarah Palin is primitive or whatever. I think that we are dealing here with a well-calculated strategy. It is a populist strategy of their message, you know, maybe it's too risky, the Democrat strategy, to repeat again and again, but where are your detailed proposals, where is your program? But I think the Republican strategy is precisely not to give you a program. But basically, the message is full reliance, at least it was in this convention, on the simplistic populism. The message is, we understand your rage, we cannot understand what goes on, and we will act. You know, like, they are not giving you a detailed account of it. They are simply enacting the simple populist rage. And here comes a true danger. I think that when people like that are elected, in order to function, and they will function, then behind every populist, there has to be a manipulator. Like, no George Bush without, how was that freaky guy called, Karl Rove, or who, you know? So the only question that interests me today is, even if I accept it, why not? Maybe that personally John McCain is honest. All is possible in this universe, no? But my question is, who will be his Karl Rove? You see the paradox. The paradox of they who advocate this populist transparency are creating conditions for typical postmodern form of power, where you have the populist front and behind the anonymous manipulators, experts, and so on and so on. So I'm shocked that how even a guy who wrote a lot against bullshitting, you know, Harry Frankfurt and that mega bestseller, which is bullshit or bullshitting, was, it's a mega bestseller. I think it sold here 500,000 copies and so on. I read an interview with him. You know, when he also goes against politicians, they're bullshitting all the time. Then when asked, but do you know a politician who is not bullshitting? He says John McCain. Poor guy. I mean, poor guy. You know what's, but here I'm sincere, I'm not just cynical. You know what's the problem? The problem is that when the situation is complex, sincerity is a false category, structurally. Sincerity means you explode in populist rage. Enough of this decadence, we don't know what's going on, you ignore complexity, you just give way to your rage. And that's, I think, between the lines, the perverse message, two-level message that Republicans are effectively giving you. Now, I will try to explicate the message very naively. It is, we know you are furious. We allow you to enact your fury. We are with you here. And you and we all secretly know that things are not as simple as that. But don't worry about that. We will have our experts who will secretly do the job of necessary manipulations and so on, so that you don't have to worry. You can explode in your rage, we will have great fun, you will not have to think. Our Karl Rove and so on will secretly do the job. That's for me the message between the lines. But now comes a little bit more of a, before conclusion, of a serious theory, if you have the nerves for it. That's now for me the crucial part. Namely, this Republican strategy is part of something which I like to describe in my violence book as, incidentally, since I published two books recently, I hope you noticed the relationship, violence and in defense of lost causes. Violence is the more civilized one in the politico-ideological way. I had to make some compromises. I almost withdrew the book. They wanted me to take out some parts, for example, when I claimed that in original version that the main problem with Hitler is that he wasn't violent enough, no? And then they exploded. What, do you want him to call, to kill all the Jews and so on? And I made my point. No, exactly not. For me, this kind of violent outbursts are precisely signs of impotence. Hitler had to kill the Jews because to mask the fact that he really didn't change anything at the level of fundamental social relations and so on and so on. Okay, but that's another story. What I want to say is that these two books are like, again, the more condensed abstract version and then all the dirty political consequences you get them in defense of lost causes. But what interests me in the central thesis of both books is how today we have a rise of a new form of violence, more and more, which is what I would have called not only objective but abstract violence. violence no longer experienced as violence which can be attributed to a concrete person. This policeman did that, that manager did that. But it's violence which almost gets naturalized as a kind of a social tsunami, financial crisis, earthquake, even war is experienced like that. And now I come to the question, a little bit of theory if you have now some patience. What happens in our psychic identity when we are victims of this kind of violence? Here I would like briefly to refer to a book which I like very much, Catherine Malabou, a young French philosopher who was also a pupil of Derrida and wrote an excellent book on Hegel, it's translated, called The Future of Hegel, L'Avenir de Hegel. Her last book is called Le Nouveau Blessé, The New Wounded. And it's a very consistent, I don't agree with that part, but it's interesting, critique of psychoanalysis. What is Malabou's thesis? It is that the basic feature of psychoanalysis when it deals with traumas is a delicate echoing between internal and external real. For Freud and Lacan, whenever you are a victim of external real, brutal rape, natural disaster, whatever, we can talk about trauma only when the external real resuscitates a pre-existing inner psychic trauma. The model of this would have been, you probably know it, the well-known Freudian dream, Father, can't you see I'm burning? Well, the external, okay, very small trauma is, you know, a father whose kid died recently, spends the night awakened by the kid's dead body, and then he falls asleep and has this terrible vision of the son approaching him, telling him, Father, can't you see that I'm burning? Then the father awakens and gets what happened. While he was asleep, a candle fell, was overturned, and so the cloth covering the body caught fire. And what then the father did is what you usually do, you must know this from your own experience, whenever an external sign, disturbance, makes difficult you to continue to sleep. For example, you know, a phone is ringing. In order to gain some time and prolong your sleep, you quickly construct a dream in which phone ringing is part of the dream, so that you gain some time. The problem is now, why do you then awaken? The standard theory is simply when the external signal becomes too strong. Like, if there is a phone ringing, you can go on sleeping a little bit. But if I then approach and kick you strongly, it's difficult to go on dreaming. No, and, but Lacan's reading is the opposite one. It's not this, it's that. First, the father escapes into dream to be able to go on sleeping. But then, that's the beauty of Lacanian reading, of this Freudian dream. What you encounter in dream is much more terrifying real than reality itself. In this case, what does it mean? Father, can't you see I'm burning? It's one big reproach. Probably he felt very guilty for his son's death and so on. And that you awaken not because the external signal was too strong. You awaken to escape the traumatic real, the inner real, trauma that you encountered in your dream. That's the psychoanalytic dispositif. It is very useful. Freud sticks to it to the end. Even in his text on war traumatism, he claims that even when you get extremely brutal violence, like bombs exploding, you lose your limbs, and so on, still, we can speak about trauma only when the external violence resuscitates an inner trauma. And I think that it is true that in many cases of violence, it functions like this, like even with rapes. This is my old thesis, who is problematic for some feminists, but most feminists with whom I spoke, they tend to agree with it, that what is truly humiliating about rape is precisely not that it's simply an external brutality, but that what if, and I think if you're a woman, you shouldn't feel bad about it. Why not? You have, my God, the right to have any fantasies you want. What if you already had deep in yourself some masochist and so on fantasies? I claim that in this case, rape will be much more devastating for you. The most brutal, almost, experience psychologically you can have is that when, what is your innermost dream that you cannot even bring yourself to publicly bringing it out? When your innermost fantasizing content of your innermost fantasies is brutally imposed onto you from outside. So I hope you got my point. I hope it's very pro-feminist. My point is that when we get the disgusting male chauvinist saying, oh, but the bitch, when I raped her, got only what she secretly wanted. The usual feminist way is to say either, no, this is just male fantasy, or the opposite. Or to say, if it's not only a male fantasy, the poor woman was just the victim of she internalized patriarchal ideology. I would say, why? Why blame the victim? You almost make her the victim. My idea would have been, why should there be any link between your fantasizing and what you get from the outside? I think that even if this is true, that you as a woman were secretly fantasizing about, okay, maybe not rape, but being slightly brutally handled, this gives to the guy no right to rape you, if anything, it's even worse. I think that if it's true what the guy says, the punishment should be double, that you get instead of 5-10 years or whatever. We can go up to death penalty, I don't have any problems with death penalty and so on. So let me go on. So what Catherine Malabou claims is that nonetheless this thesis of echoing between inner and outer trauma no longer works in today's different examples from totally different fields which generate the so-called post-traumatic subject. It can be totally different thing. It can be external natural violence, tsunami, earthquake. It can be psychic violence. It can be torture, military violence. It can be even a purely natural brain process like Alzheimer's or whatever. The result is the same. And Malabou is well aware that the first model of this post-traumatic subjectivity are the so-called Muslims, the living dead of concentration camps. So her point is that you can have brutal traumatic experience whose impact cannot any longer be accounted for in the Freudian terms of external trauma resuscitating an inner trauma. Why? Because the external trauma is so strong that it, for example, in the case of Alzheimer's, it physically obliterates all your texture of symbolic identity. You know, you cannot say a trauma, this is the metaphor we are usually using, that an external violent experience arouses, reawakens some deep, half forgotten traumas and so on and so on. But here there is nothing to arouse because, for example, as a patient of Alzheimer's, you literally lose everything. All your unconscious traces, your symbolic universe, and so on and so on, all this is erased, which is why you can no longer play the psychoanalytic hermeneutics here. The result of these different traumatic experiences is this subject, post-traumatic subject, which is a kind of a living dead. A subject who still, and that's the point where Malabou has something to say against psychoanalysis. We get a subject who still is some kind of subjectivity, in the sense of it is aware of him or herself, he or she can talk, superficially interact, but you know that the clinical description is well known. It is the subject who simply, as we put it, lacks psychological depth. It is no longer in Heideggerian sense the engaged subject, the subject who, you know, has projects towards the future, then looks to the past and constitutes his life as meaningful and so on and so on. It's a subject who is empty, impassive, without engagement, without emotional, without power of empathy and so on and so on. It's this well-known experience, as we say, when you look a subject like this into the eye, you see nothing. That spark, mysterious spark of life, is missing. And Malabou has here an excellent point, I think, against all those guys whom we like very much. They give wonderful descriptions, like Oliver Sacks, or especially his teacher, the great Soviet neuro... divine sign, okay, that's never... neurologist Alexander Luria. What they do, for example, in Luria's wonderful book on the mnemonist case, a guy who was had the misfortune of remembering everything. And Luria asked the right question. Not only what is the brain causality, what happens in his brain, but how did he subjectivize his predicament to be able to survive? And Luria gives a wonderful description of a typical obsessional attitude. The guy was all the time waiting for something to happen. It was always something will arrive, but never does arrive. But what's the problem here? Also with Oliver Sacks, like the man who mistook his wife for a hat and so on. The story is always that of redemption, a neuronal trauma. You cannot identify others' faces or whatever. Ruins you, but then what we hear from all these guys is, as it were, the good story. How? In the case of the man who mistook his wife for a hat, through music, you slowly reintegrate yourself. But Malabou's question is, but nonetheless, what is that zero level subjectivity before you try, if you can at all, to reintegrate yourself? The paradox is that it is still a mode of subjectivity. You are somebody, but in contrast to what people from Rorty onwards are claiming, when they claim that we are stories we are telling ourselves about ourselves. No, here all the stories are erased. You survive as a kind of an empty subject. Now, to conclude, 2 points. First, I will not go into technical argumentation about why I think that she, Malabou, is wrong if she thinks this is a case against psychoanalysis. I think that on the contrary, for psychoanalysis, this kind of erasure, loss of substance, is the very constitutive moment of subjectivity. But that's another story. Where she is right, I think, is to emphasize how this problem of post-traumatic subject, in the sense of this living dead, deprived of all psychic substance, is a fundamental philosophical and political problem. Her thesis is that if the 20th century was Freudian, the century of resuscitated old traumas and so on, the forthcoming century will be the century of these traumatized, empty subjects. And now I come to my point. What does this notion of post-traumatic subjectivity, a detached subject deprived of his or her symbolic substance, what does it mean politically? I think it means quite something if we try to reconceptualize the notion of communism. What do I mean by this? Let me first, to provoke you a little bit, read you a nice quote from the last book by Alain Badiou. Sounds crazy, I subscribe it. Quote, the communist hypothesis remains the good one. I do not see any other. If we have to abandon this hypothesis, then it is no longer worth doing anything at all in the field of collective action. Without the horizon of communism, without this idea, there is nothing in the historical and political becoming of any interest to a philosopher. Let everyone bother about his own affairs and let us stop talking about it. However, to hold on to the communist idea does not mean that we should retain its first form of presentation, which was centered on property and state. In fact, what is imposed on us as a task, even as a philosophical obligation, is to help a new mode of existence of the communist hypothesis to deploy itself. I think that the topic of post-traumatic subject is very useful here. In what sense? Today we have a problem with socialist alternatives and so on. I mean, there are good cases to say, but wait a minute, at least in the Western countries, at no point in the human history had so many people lived in comparatively such good conditions, so why even dream of a global alternative? Isn't it enough to say that in the same way that once we were dreaming about socialism with a human face, let's dream about global capitalism with a human face. A little bit more women's rights, a little bit more tolerance, this, that, but basically things stay the way they are. So the problem is this enough? Or to put it in old-fashioned Marxist terms, are there antagonisms which, even in the long term, especially in the long term, global capitalism will not be able to cope with, to resolve? I think they are. I will not now spend too much of your time. You must be even more exhausted than me. I saw this. So I claim there are at least three, four. First, ecology. No, wait a minute. Here, I'm not a total idiot. I'm well aware that, in a way, capitalism, one should use also capitalist mechanisms, you know, the so-called externalities included into the price. But there is one problem, I think. The stakes are too high. Let's be frank here, without any cheap anti-capitalism. Capitalist market mechanisms work when you had time to do trial, error, and so on. You try this, that, competition, blah, blah. But sorry, we cannot say we have one Chernobyl, let's try different Chernobyl, and so on. The stakes are too high. We cannot do it. Then we have, I claim, the so-called problem of intellectual property. I think that signs are clear already today. That's why it's such a problem, intellectual property, that intellectual property, so-called, is by nature communist. It's very difficult to contain intellectual products into the form of private property. That's for me the lesson of Bill Gates. Not that he's a bad guy, but that if market mechanisms were to be allowed to have their free run, one guy would have owned practically our entire linguistic symbolic substance. The third problem I see is biogenetics and all these things. Things are happening here which are, I think, of tremendous importance. Things which define our very substance of being human. Without any exaggeration, for example, I'm fascinated when I follow all these experiments, what they can do today. For example, what fascinated me is that, as you probably know, it was reported in the media, they, scientists, already can, at a very elementary level, true, but nonetheless, directly wire, as they put it, our brains, so that we can directly interact with a computer without even Stephen Hawking's finger moving, just directly. You think about it, computer reads the basic direction of your thought, and then if you link computer to a machine, we are already at that level that you can play simple video games. Like, you can move objects in reality with your thought alone. I claim there is something terrifying in it, without any reactionary panic. Why? Because this is something that goes against our very basic notion of being human, of having the freedom of thought. Our human identity is based on the idea, I am here, reality is there. You don't know what I think. This idea, I have my own space. Now it sounds good, divine. I think about something, it happens. But let's not forget that it goes also the other way around. Then people can make something happen and you will think about it. So I am now in contact with certain group of journalists who are doing something, I think, wonderful if it's true. From what I was able to judge, they are not the crazy paranoiacs, because it's not expected what they are discovering. What they are discovering, I was told, is that not only you in the United States, but in many other countries, scientists who work for military and security services already are well deep into this process. We already can identify, because our brain is matter, our emotional attitudes are certain electromagnetic waves and so on, waves which are the result of you feeling anxiety, courage, whatever. So the idea has come, can we technologically generate these waves, bombard you with them, so that then when I press the button, as it were, you become courageous in a panic and so on and so on. And from what is slowly emerging, again, I'm not blaming only you. You, China, whoever, all big powers are deep, deep into it and are very far. So you see what's my point here, is that something is happening, my God, which in a way changes the very definition, the way we understood it of being human. And for me, again, to leave this to the market is madness. Even the guy who is usually held as the one who idealizes the end of history, Francis Fukuyama, let's admit it that in his next book, which is not very good, it's too simplistic, but modestly interesting, that post-human future or whatever, he admits that the very fact of biogenetics ruins his thesis of the end of history. He says it changes the coordinates so much that all of a sudden he's now, if not a state socialist, at least a state capitalist. He emphasizes that we need a strong social intervention and so on. But again, what has this to do with Malabou, with this thesis of post-traumatic subject? Here I come to communism. I claim that in all three cases that I've described, we are doing with something for which we should use the good old Marxist term, you know, apropos the early accumulation of capital, the enclosure of commons. Something which should be our shared social substance is taken from us. Isn't ecology, what we call ecological topic, doesn't it mean that the commons of our shared nature, natural presuppositions, natural substance, is ruined, we are being deprived of it? What does biogenetic means that our collective inner life substance, the biogenetic substance, is potentially taken from us? What does intellectual property mean? That our symbolic social substance is taken from us. So I think that, now I go a little bit quickly because I've spoken too much, but you will see my scheme, which is that in all these three levels, the same process is going on. We are more and more reduced to some kind of equivalent of post-traumatic subject. Empty subjectivity, well, all our substance, natural, symbolic, is taken from us. In this sense, I think we should maybe redefine today what Marx called the proletarian position. It's not only the worker who is exploited, maybe not even primarily. It's all these different levels where we are emerging as proletarians in the sense of abstract Cartesian subjects, like post-traumatic subjects deprived of the substance. And this is where we are today, and the name for what we should fight, precisely because what is threatened is our commons, our communal substance, I still think, although it may sound as cheap provocation, whatever you want, that communism is still the right name for this. I'm sorry if I was too long. Thanks very much for your patience.